please go to the Fischler College of Education and School of Criminal Justice YouTube channel to check out my recent appearance with Dr. Telesco, where she and I analyze the disappearance to discovery of Bo Mann. Tatiana Lupaca was a 27-year-old from the former Soviet Union country of Latvia. She had a husband and two daughters. On January 25th, 1999, while living in New York City alone, Tatiana told a family member that she was going to Miami and would be back soon. She was never seen again. I'm Ed Denzel, and this is Unfound. We here in my country, the United States, we have a responsibility to not only find our fellow citizens who have gone missing, but foreigners who are here as well. The perception of people coming to the United States and disappearing is not a reputation that should ever be accepted. Hey, I know, people come here to vacation, to work, to live, and it's a big country. Lots can go wrong. Still, it is our job to make sure things go right when others are here. So how are we doing? Well, according to Unfound stats, not so well. Every non-citizen we've featured who has gone missing in the United States is still missing. Those names include Elena Carissi, David Medot, Omar Shear, and Kent Monroe. Well, today with Tatiana Lupaca, she was here, then she disappeared. What happened during her coming to America? And now a summary of the case. Tatiana Lupaca, yep, that's how her last name is pronounced, was born in Latvia when it was still a part of the Soviet Union. After the wall fell, her country gained its independence from the Russians, and Tatiana became a citizen of this country on the Baltic Sea. She got married and had two daughters. Yet, Tatiana and her family longed for more. Thus, she gained access to living in the United States and moved here in the summer of 1998. The plan was for Tatiana to get her citizenship. Then her husband and children could then move here as well. While the process moved forward, Tatiana took various jobs in New York City, such as a nanny and a waitress in Brighton Beach. So, on the morning of January 25th, 1999, Tatiana spoke to her mother on the phone. Tatiana said she was going to Miami. This would be Tatiana's second trip there, the first being with a family where she was the nanny. Tatiana, for the second trip, though, did not give any details, not even saying how long she would be gone. However, Tatiana knew important paperwork regarding her U.S. citizenship application would be coming in the mail sometime in late January. Tatiana hung up the phone with her mother. She was never seen again. That paperwork arrived just as Tatiana expected a few days later. Strangely, years later, a man who claimed he knew Tatiana ended up with many of her possessions, including her passport. Tatiana's family never did move here. If you think resolving disappearances of citizens in their own countries is difficult, try resolving ones with people going missing in foreign lands. It adds several additional layers of complexity, as I think we've discovered here on Unfound. Contemplate what can be done to change this, while you also try to answer these three questions during the interview. Number one, why didn't Tatiana ever tell anyone the name of the Jewish family where she was the nanny? Number two, Tatiana really wouldn't have walked out of her life to start a new one when she was on the verge of becoming a U.S. citizen, would she? And number three, what do you make of Walter, a guy who voluntarily admitted and proved that he had most of Tatiana's stuff? Tatiana's family knows she never would have abandoned them willingly. The guest for this episode is Tatiana's oldest daughter, Ilana. Unfound News. You might want to check out the Silver Linings podcast. I'll be doing a live recording on it on November 29th. However, I do not think it will be publicly available until at least a few weeks later. Next, although I wasn't there, I believe that my assistant Emily's wedding went off perfectly this past weekend. I wish her and her husband a lifetime of joy. Finally, very sad news. Former guest Kristen Dennis, sister of Brandy Myers, died back in early October. My understanding is the cause was a head injury from an accident. This kind of news hurts every time. I'm so happy to have on this episode of Unfound the daughter of Tatiana Lupaca, Ilana. Ilana, welcome to Unfound.
Hello, thank you.
Let's start here. Everybody, I think it's very important for this disappearance, being that it's about 25 years old and you are Tatiana's daughter, to really understand that, of course, you were just a little girl at the time. So maybe we should go through that first. Tell the listeners about how old were you were at the time, and, you know, what do you remember about that time? Of course, your mother's here in the United States. You're over there where she's originally from. And, you know, just talk about that time, but most importantly, make sure everybody knows how old you were in 1999.
Sure, thank you. So I was 7 years old when my mom went to America.
Okay.
In 1998. I just remember that I was a very happy child and much loved child, and I've spent all my 7 years with my mom. I never went to preschool or any daycare. And in Latvia, we start school when we are seven. Mm-hmm. So I went to school just right after she left. But yeah, I was very lucky to spend every day with her.
Okay. And of course, your father was or is very involved in your life. So you were living with him once you moved to the United States?
Yeah. Okay. So before my mom went, we all were living together. Uh-huh. And yeah.
Okay. And do you have any other siblings? You don't have to say their names or anything, but I'm just wondering, are you an only child or what?
No, I have a younger sister.
You do?
She was only three years old at that time. So she doesn't really remember my mom at all, our mom.
Right. Okay. So seven in 1998 when she went to the United States.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Do you remember, of course, 7 years old, do you remember her leaving? I'm guessing you were really sad about that. But of course, we know she was moving there, hoping that you and your sister and your father would, of course, follow her to the United States. Do you remember seeing her for the last time? Is that something that's still etched in your mind, or are you just a little too young to remember that?
Oh, no, I remember everything.
Okay.
I would say I remember most of the things, like most of my mom. I guess because she left when I was seven, and I was kind of waiting for the time when we go and see her.
Right.
So I kept all the memories that I had for 7 years since I was seven. That's what I remember about her, like almost everything. And sometimes when I look in the mirror, I see her. I do remember her eyes, her look, her voice. Like her sister's voice is very similar to hers. Right. And when she would call us, me as a child, I would think it's my mom, but then I would realize it's not. But yeah, my mom was really beautiful, like not only as a woman, but also as a human. Like her personality was really, really nice. And yeah, I have a lot of warm memories from those days, like how we used to cook together or clean the house together. And I think I was so lucky to spend all my 7 years with her, because I think she did like her best of being best mother. And yeah, I remember how she was teaching me everything and getting me ready for school, which I was supposed to start in September after she was gone. And I remember how we were like singing and dancing together during the days.
Yeah.
She was really good fun. Yeah. And I think like I remember how she was the only mom in our neighborhood who was playing outside with all the kids, like all my friends, me, participating in all our games. And she was very much loved by everyone, even in our neighborhood. I think I didn't lose just my mother, like I also lost my best friend.
Yeah.
And I know that she would always be by my side whenever I would need her the most, if she would never go missing.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. I mean, of course, you're 7 years old. You're not going to be involved in that decision. But what if now as an adult, or maybe even, of course, maybe for many years now, do you remember, have you learned what brought this on for her decision to come to the United States? Is your father, or maybe other family members who are from your country there, have passed along to you, you know, what went into her final decision to come here? Do you know?
Definitely I know. There was, you know, the back then, time in Latvia was really hard and difficult, and a lot of people would try to move somewhere else.
Okay.
Because obviously after Soviet Union was like full apart, and the countries were really struggling and the families living in them. So my mom and dad, they were thinking to move to America, to New York together, all as a family, but it was almost not possible to do it all at the same time with kids and four of us.
Right.
My dad's auntie, she used to live in America at that time, and she still is. So my dad kind of had idea of going there first and settle and then bring all of us over to America. But then after they had conversation with the auntie, she was like saying and suggesting that it would be best if my mom would go first and stay with her in a flat. And it would be just easier for her to live with a woman first of all rather than a man, even though it's my dad's auntie. And also, that auntie, she had a friend or so who was disabled, and she was using a wheelchair and she needed someone to look after her. And my mom was like good for that, you know, and that was a good start as well for my mom to settle and earn some money as well while looking after her. So yeah, they made a decision that my mom should go first then, in that case, stay with my auntie and do all the necessary things that had to be done in order for us to come over as well. She got 6 months visa to go to New York, and she thought she was very lucky to get that because not everyone could get visa
right
at that time. And I remember her getting ready for that, like packing, and I remember her words when she was saying that I'm the oldest and I have to look after my sister, I have to look after my dad until we're all reunion and like we'll be together again. So yeah, I actually took it, I think, a bit too serious. And I was really, really trying to look after my sister and, until now. Feeling a lot of responsibility.
Right.
And I remember like how my mom left me lots of her clothes and, you know, makeup and nail varnish and all that. When she left.
Okay. All right. So there was a plan in place that she did it through the official channels. She gets this work visa. She's coming to the United States. And then the plan was eventually for your father and your sister to all come and join her in the United States, I guess, with the eventual prospect that you would become American citizens, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
So, like, obviously they were planning to settle and leave there.
Yeah. Great.
But when my mom was there, she obviously started with applying for asylum.
Thank you for that. So that was the decision process. Of course, you're 7 years old. You know what's going on, but you're really not involved in the decision process. You know, they're not going to, I guess, at 7 years old, they're not going to ask your opinion on it. So she gets here, and I'm not asking for a specific date, but what month of 1998 was it?
It was after her birthday, sometime end of July, maybe very beginning of August, but yeah.
Okay, July of August of 1998.
Yeah.
Okay, I remember the time. Well, it seems like yesterday. I can't believe that's 26 years ago now. That's just after I had moved to Las Vegas. It seems like yesterday. All right, so she moves, but there was a plan. It wasn't like she was coming here and she was, she didn't know anybody here. Like you said, I guess somebody on your father's side already lived here.
Yeah, my dad's auntie.
Okay.
So she stayed with her
mm-hmm.
at the beginning, and that was a plan, actually, to stay with her until we come over, but it went a bit other way.
Okay.
And also there was my auntie's relative. I'm not sure exactly who exactly she was to her, but yeah, definitely a woman who then did a report to police when my mom got missing.
Right. Of course, we'll get to that. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So your understanding is when she got here in, you know, the late summer of 98, did she automatically start applying for the paperwork, or is that something she waited on? What is your understanding?
My understanding, they were, like, my mom and my dad were discussing it all the time, like, of step by step how to do it. And I think my dad's auntie and their relative, they both were trying to help her of, like, where to start from, where to go first, what to do, and how to bring us over. And so, because I have some letters from my mom, and in some of them, like, she writes to my dad of what he needs to get, what documents he needs to collect and send her.
Right. Okay. All right. And so, and everybody should know, to kind of foreshadow this, that she went missing right before that paperwork, you know, was kind of coming to a head, where she was going to have some, have some sort of meeting where the paperwork was going to finally come through, correct?
Yeah, that's right. It was so close. She actually, I think she was doing it in a really good timing.
Yeah.
Like, she's been in America for 6 months, about 6 months, almost 6 months, before she got missing. And she was really good on all the timings, applying for asylum. And, like, she got all the letters and notice to go to USA Department of Justice Immigration and Translation Service for her fingerprints. And it was, like, very final steps for her and my dad to do fingerprints so my dad can come over with us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and so while she was here between, let's just say, August of 98 and January of 99, you already talked about letters, but how often, do you remember how often you talked on the phone, how often she would write, how often your father would write back, maybe you wrote something to her as well, how often was the communication between all of you?
I think pretty much every month we would receive a letter from her, so that would be like, we would receive a letter from her, then my dad would reply to her. And I remember myself, like, writing cards for my mom and sending it over.
Mm-hmm.
And so that would be, like, pretty much every month. Then phone calls maybe would happen also once or twice a month. Like, she would call us or we would call her. Because obviously it was quite expensive that time. We didn't have anything like WhatsApp now. So we had to, go to those telephone booths and, like, drop coins. And while the coins are running.
Yeah, those were the days, right? Right, Ilana? Those were the days.
Yeah. Like, okay, last few pennies left.
Yeah. In contrast to how we're doing this interview today, which is some a way that did not even exist way back in 1998-99. Did not even exist. Okay. Thank you. So,
and also,
please continue. Sorry. Go ahead.
There was not only lectures and only phone calls, but there were also like parcels. She would send us like a huge parcels with gifts, like full of presents for everyone from America, like not only for me, my sister, my dad, but also like for his parents, for his like family, relatives, and everyone who she used to miss back in Latvia.
Yeah. You're gonna.
So that was nice.
Yeah, you're gonna, as an American myself, you're gonna have to tell me what kind of thing. Do you remember some of the things that she sent here from my country, the United States? Do you remember?
Yes, of course. I was like the top girl in the school, wearing all these cool skirts and tops from America. Like they were so different than what we had in Latvia.
Right.
I remember those like a fleece cardigans and like. Or Dalmatian print skirt okay. for myself. There were also that old McDonald singing frog.
All right, yes.
That was like, no one like in my school had anything like that. And wow. I had like the best toys because she would send like all singing Barbies, like you would press on the star on her chest. And she would start singing, and everyone was just like, wow, it's from.
Okay. That is some pretty cool stuff. I was a little worried, like, she was going to, like, she was sending, like, beef jerky or Slim Jims or something from the United States. I wasn't sure what you meant by that for a second. Maybe you could ship stuff like that because it's particular, some foods, and, you know, we have some quirky things going on over here.
Okay, no. All cute and things like we didn't have in Latvia. She also sent to my dad like good perfume, or she also sent him a coat. It was a leather coat, like really proper good coat for him to wear during winter. And guess what? He's still keeping it. Like he did not wear it too much just to make sure it's safe, like, and he has it.
Yeah.
So he kind of wears them only on special occasions, and we actually still have a lot of things from her.
Wow.
I think if one day we will see her, she will be like really impressed.
Wow. Okay. Thank you. So in general, we're going to get into some specifics of what went on here, you know, before she went missing, but just in general, how would you say the feelings you got from talking to her, what your father said, the letters and everything? How was it going over here? Did it meet her expectations, or what would you say?
Sorry, the last sentence you said.
I'm just asking how was it going for her over here? You know, she was excited to come over here, you know, from your home country. And so did it meet her expectations? Was she kind of let down being here? Was she still excited to be here or what? How was it going over those 6 months?
Yeah, no, I think she took it as a huge opportunity in her life as like improved life for her family, for herself. She was really amazed of like how America is so different to what she seen before, like Latvia and other countries, like Kazakhstan, let's say, where she grew up. And this was like a completely different world to her. And now me holding letters from her, like reading, and I can see that she was writing about it, of like how great America is, how friendly everyone is. She was amazed by opportunities, I guess. Of course, money-wise, you know, the pay was so different to whatever they used to get in Latvia. And she was very impressed by that.
Yeah.
I actually was talking to some of her friends, and they also would say that she would call them and be like, look, it's amazing here. As soon as I settle here, I will bring you all over, and we're all gonna live together here in America.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. All right. So things going pretty well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. She was working hard.
All right. Well, let's go right into that. Your understanding, and once again, later we're going to get into some of the specifics of a few of these things, but your understanding of the work she was doing while she was here before she went missing, I understand that she might have been a nanny for a particular family and some other things. What do you know?
Well, so as I said, she started with helping looking after that old lady who's in a wheelchair. Right. And she was living with my dad's auntie. As I know, until the point when she had a bit of a conflict with my auntie, when then she had to move out of her flat. But it was because my dad's auntie, she, as far as I know, she was a bit strict, and she would be telling to my mom, like, not to put too much makeup because my mom is pretty already enough. And so she doesn't bring too much attention.
Uh-huh.
'Cause my mom had like very white skin, dark hair, blue eyes. And if she would put like a red lipstick on and some mascara, that's it. So, but my mom, like, yeah, she used to really like look after herself, even though she was pretty as she was. And so, yeah, the auntie said, oh, maybe you shouldn't put the makeup really on. And then my mom didn't like being told that because, you know, I'm a grown up woman.
Right. She's an adult.
So she didn't like that. Then my mom was very generous and she would buy something for the house because obviously she was appreciating the point that she could stay in the auntie's house. So she would buy something for the house, and again auntie would go like, don't waste your money, keep all your money for your family when they come your reunion, like just keep sending money, don't get anything. And I guess it was like rolling on and on when my mom was like, I can do what I feel I have to do. And she didn't like to be being told off, you know, like not to go somewhere very late. Don't do this, don't do that. Stay here. Because obviously auntie was worried probably. Because she maybe was feeling some sort of responsibility for my mom. Because she was only 27. Now when I think, I'm already older than her.
Huh. It's crazy. I'm twice as old as that. So, yeah. I should ask. Did you find this all out? Were these things that you, maybe your father knew or other people knew before she went missing, or were these things that were just discovered after she went missing? You kind of this interaction between her and your auntie.
Well, I believe this was my mom's as well explanation to my dad that she can't stay with her anymore. That's too much, and she wants to move somewhere. And so, because my dad also was like, "Why did you have to move to Brooklyn?" Because she stayed in New Jersey with the auntie.
Mm-hmm.
Not New Jersey, sorry. Manhattan.
Okay.
And she moved to Brooklyn.
Okay.
And so my dad was like, why do you have to move? Because she paid quite a big amount of money for that room in Brooklyn. But my mom was like, oh, it's not possible to stay with her. It's just too much.
Mm-hmm.
And then afterwards as well, kind of my family knew that, yes, auntie had a bit of that strict attitude and character. Mm. And my mom was quite independent as well, with a strong character.
So. All right, so going back to my question, of course, she's sending you a lot of stuff. You talked about the Barbie. You talked about this jacket that she sent your father. So she was taking care of this woman or this person in a wheelchair. What about other jobs she might have had?
And she had that job only while she was living with auntie. And then once she moved out of auntie's house, which I believe should be around like early October, looking at the letters.
Okay.
Because like on 5th of October, we already received a letter from her Brooklyn address.
Okay, great.
So I believe maybe end of September she moved out already. And then she told my dad that she was working as like a nanny and housekeeping in Brooklyn, in one of the Jewish family houses, like just cleaning and looking after kids. And I remember her as well talking in the letter about like how she wants her kids have the same life as what those kids have. And she was like, oh, I see like how many things they have, and I want my children to have that as well. And this was motivating her a lot, like to work more, to work harder. Mm-hmm. And she was writing in the letters as well about like how much she works, and she has very little sleep. Like she sleeps very short hours, and just because she wants it to be over and like get us there quickly. And by the time we come, she was hoping, you know, to have a good place for us and all that.
Right. Did she also say something about working at a place in Brighton Beach? We don't have to get into the name of her or anything, but she talked like a nightclub or a restaurant or something like that in Brighton Beach. Did she mention that as well, or is that not something you found out until after she went missing?
Yeah, that was only after, and that was from her friend. So my mom wasn't telling anyone about this, just to her friend, because I think she didn't want either family to be worried or tell her off again, like not to do this or something. So yeah, we as a family, we all just knew about that family, Jewish family in Brooklyn, where she was cleaning the house and looking after kids.
All right. And we will come back to both of those little letters. So she's working, she's making money, she's buying things, she's shipping things back to you and your father, your younger sister, while she is here over those 6 months. The living situation, of course, she was living with the auntie, then found her own place. Your understanding, was, did she have any roommates? Was she living by herself in Brooklyn? What do you know about that?
Well, now that I know, like, I looked in Google, I've seen the picture of the house where she used to stay and live in Brooklyn, and that's like a two-floor house. And I think she was living on a second floor in a room. Mm-hmm. So she would rent a room in that house.
Okay. So she had a room, you know, so she didn't necessarily have a roommate, but there might have been other renters in that house, possibly.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know anything about them.
Okay, so she didn't, for example, she never mentioned any of their names or anything?
No, nothing like that.
Okay. Let's move on to this. The Miami trip, what did this come up in a letter? Once again, reminding everybody that Ilana was like 7 or 8 years old when all this was going down. So what can you say about the Miami trip? What do you know about it?
Well, now I have a lot of pictures that she sent us.
Okay.
So obviously she told the family that she had to, our family, that she had to go to Miami with the Jewish family, with kids, to help look after and just be with them there over the Christmas holidays. So it was in December.
Okay.
So that was all we knew at that point. And she obviously sent all the pictures, and she was very amazed by that. And I think after she seen Miami, she was like, oh no, that's not, like, it has to be Miami where we need to leave, not New York.
Forget New York City, let's go to Miami.
Exactly.
I've been to New York City once, I've been to Miami once, and I agree with your mother, I'd rather be in Miami. All right, and again, and this is not something that she made up. In fact, you have pictures from that trip, and you've shown those pictures to me. There's no doubt that that is Miami.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's correct.
And once again, remind everybody, when did this trip take place?
It was sometime in December. I don't have exact dates.
Okay.
I wouldn't even know how long it took her, like how long she was there.
All right. But she was certainly there, and these are pictures of really just her, and there's a picture of her with a guy. I don't know if we want to get into that right at this point, if ever.
Yeah.
But she's definitely there. You can see her on the beach. You can see, like, the resort where she was staying. Looked pretty nice.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Now, something else that came up, I think, like I said, I think this was after she went missing, and Fida might have come up much later. Once again, you can explain it, Ilana, is that your mother had spoken to a friend of hers in Kazakhstan about a Japanese man who wanted to give her a job or something. Why don't you talk about that as well? Because once again, it seems like she might have been going to Florida again. Why don't you talk a little bit about that?
Okay, yes. This is something I found out only recently, like a few years ago, when I was trying to ask every member of the family and friends I know about that time. And that only her very best friend who she grew up with, she told me that somebody offered my mom a job in Miami. And my mom was more of like laughing and saying about the guy because he reminded her of their friend in Kazakhstan. And so that guy was Japanese man, and he looked a lot like the Kazakhstan friend, Kazakh friend. And she's like, yeah, he just reminds me a lot of him. And so he offered me a job in Miami, and that was like a secretary job or something like that. And so apparently she only told her friend that she's going for an interview, and that was meant to be in January. So now I'm quite certain that she thought at least that she's going for interview to Miami for a bit. And she was sure that she's coming back because she knew about the interview she has in the beginning of the February for the fingerprints, because she told the auntie as well. Before she went, she told the auntie that she needs to quickly go somewhere. She's going to come back. And she told the auntie, please keep an eye. You're going to receive a letter from me, because all letters for my mom were going to the auntie's address. Mm-hmm. I guess that made sense. Like, it's important documents, and they would go to auntie's house rather than the house where everyone else lives.
Right.
So the auntie received the letters, but that was like 29th of January, and that was then 31st of January, the appointment interview.
Yep.
And my mom obviously gone missing on the 25th of January.
Right. All right, so I just need to ask you a few questions about that. As far as your mother's Kazakhstan friend could say, did your mother ever use the name of this Japanese man? Did she ever state where she met him? Because my perception of this disappearance is that she says that she's going to go to Miami again, and that's when she went missing. So I think that's why I have to ask you, did she ever offer up any information other than the guy just being Japanese?
Unfortunately, this is something that even her friend would not remember, even if my mom mentioned the name. I guess at that point, you see, no one would be focused on that.
Yeah.
Like, and so many years gone now that no one even remembers it. But definitely it was not something that my mom would stick to a particular name and tell everyone about that person, you know. That would be a different story.
Yeah.
If she mentioned once, she would never remember that name.
Right.
And I guess the information was very small as well, because if she would call someone, that would be a quick chat, because that was expensive. In a letter, again, like, what, 2-3 pages, but you would do very bare minimum still.
Right. Okay, so all we know is she talks about a Japanese guy. That we don't know if that means he's actually from Japan and just happened to be in the United States.
Yeah, Asian, I guess.
Yeah, right. Or is it just he's an American and he is of Asian ethnicity, or the race of being Asian? We're still not sure. He very well could have been a Japanese citizen in the United States. Many here doing all sorts of business. We're just not sure. But she just explained him in 1999 terms as a Japanese man.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, let's move on to that day. And you kind of already touched upon it. We're going to go over it again. That's January 25th of 1999. And was it your grandmother who actually spoke to your mother on that day?
Yes, because my grandma, who's actually my mom's mom, she lived in Kazakhstan back then. And that was her birthday, 25th of January. So my mom called her, and either it was like super early morning or night time, because obviously the time difference as well for Kazakhstan.
Sure.
And then my grandma just remembers that she called her and my grandma was sleepy or something. And my mom was like talking fast, but okay, she usually speaks fast, like she used to speak fast as well. But she was like super fast talking. I was like, okay, mom, happy birthday. I just wanted to say, wanted to be first, say happy birthday, all that. And yeah, my grandma was like, why are you rushing? Why are you so, like, she was a bit confused. It was such a, like, quick call. And like, happy birthday, very fast talking, and
right.
and that's it, really. That was the last phone conversation.
Okay. And the belief is that, once again, we already talked about this second Florida or Miami, Florida, of course. This is like the day that she was supposed to be going on this second trip.
Yeah.
Okay.
I believe that was the day, because this is when her neighbors saw her as mm-hmm. well.
Okay.
Going into white one car.
Wow. All right, so somebody actually saw her get into a vehicle, seemingly.
Yeah, okay. But actually also that day she popped into Auntie's house because she told her to keep an eye on right. the letters that my mom was expecting. She's like, I'm going to come back because I will have that interview. I need to do my fingerprints, all that, but I just have to go quickly somewhere and I'll, just make sure you receive all the letters you should expect. Then and then, this and that. And my auntie, my dad's auntie, she was also a bit concerned because my mom was looking differently. Her hair was short on that day, so she changed her hairstyle.
Wow.
Okay. She was wearing, as that auntie said, she was wearing a nice new coat. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so she just looked different, and
okay.
she didn't tell where she was going. She didn't tell her.
Okay.
But she looked differently. And my mom always had a long hair, so that was very unusual for her to go right. for short hair.
Right. Anybody who's going to see any pictures of Tatiana will see that she had long hair, so that she had short hair the last time she was seen, seemingly going on this Miami trip with something that was new, something out of the ordinary.
Yes, and also to add, she mm-hmm. told her friend as well that for her new hairstyle, someone was, I have no information of like who or what,
mm-hmm.
But apparently there was a man sitting in a hairdresser salon who paid for that, and she just mentioned that he was there and he paid for my hairstyle. I guess she was just excited of having a new job, and she wanted to get the interview done. But
there was somebody, there was a guy actually at where she was getting her haircut, like kind of directing things, kind of saying, well, you have to get your haircut this way.
Not that she would mention something in a bad way, that somebody made her to do that.
Okay.
It's more that she was excited about it.
Okay, gotcha. Now, either with your grandmother or your auntie, did she ever say anything about needing to get to the airport or how long she was going to be gone? Did she ever use any names?
No, she didn't say anything like that to anyone. And none of our family members actually knew that she is planning to go somewhere. She only told this to her best friend in Kazakhstan. And she only mentioned to Auntie because she said, like, oh, I need to quickly go somewhere, do something. And, I'll come to your house, I don't know, in a week time. And, I'll just come and take the letters that you receive.
Wow. Okay. And, of course, she was right. Those things in the mail did show up regarding her citizenship. But they got there after she went missing. And, of course, she never reappeared since.
Yeah.
So your mother was right about that. Those papers were coming. But she wasn't there to get them.
Yeah, that's correct.
All right, very good. Let's move on to this. Now, kind of probably people already get an idea what the answer is going to be, but I'm going to ask you anyway. What was the red flag, as we say here in the disappearance community? What was the first red flag that somebody knew wasn't, something wasn't right here? Who was that person? And, how did that person react? What did that person do?
You mean after we found out she got missing?
Well, yeah. I guess the question is, when did somebody get the idea, something's not right? We think that she's supposed to be back from this trip and she hasn't come back. Who was that person?
Oh, okay. Well, you see, we didn't know that she was actually on a trip. Right. That was when my grandma called my dad, and I was actually there. I was in a house, and I remember that conversation where my dad goes like, what, Tanya? I don't remember. I don't know. No, maybe like, I don't remember now, like when, but obviously my grandma was asking him, like, when did you last spoke to Tanya? And he was like, oh, actually, yeah, I don't know. And then I don't know what he said, like a week ago or so. Unfortunately, I don't think I should have confirmed with them, to be honest, like, maybe 2 or 3 weeks were passed after they last had a phone call from her.
Okay.
So they were like, that's strange. Yeah, she didn't call me or you for a while now. And then actually looking at the missing report, where our relative went to police and reported, that was February 26th.
Wow. Like a month later.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so it was your mother's mother, your grandmother, who was like, you know, I haven't heard from her in a while. You know, what's going on? And that's kind of what got started. What about, of course, your auntie got your father's auntie got this paperwork. I'm guessing that she must have known something wasn't right either, that Tatiana didn't come over to get that paperwork. You know, on the 30th, January 30th or February 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, she never came back. I'm guessing she probably thought something was up as well.
Yeah, well, I guess they all were calling each other at that time, but unfortunately, I don't know much about that part. Okay. But obviously, my dad had her phone number and my grandma had her phone number, so I'm sure they were calling each other. And actually, I remember my grandma telling me that she called the auntie asking about, like, when did you see her last, what happened and all that. And I think auntie also confirmed that she's seen her on the 25th, where she had a short haircut, and she also seen her going into the car.
Okay. So what's done? You already stated that somebody connected to your auntie went and made a police report on not until February 26th. So like I said, we're talking like a month after this, after joining January 25th. Was it in that time that your father actually attempted to come to the United States and was denied? Was it in that time or later? What can you say about that?
I just remember how my dad was always trying to go to America, and I know that he was trying to go to America embassy in Latvia for about like 2 or 3 times applying for visa, but they would always make a bad point about it and saying like, oh, do you want to get missing, same as your wife there? So it was quite not nice. And I remember how he would describe his feelings, like just within the family. And I would just always listen to all those stories of how he would feel ashamed, like facing that. And they would say it into his face. I was like, oh, why do you need to go there? Do you want to get missing as your wife did? So,
oh my goodness.
So he did like 2 or 3 times trying to go. And then all the family was like, oh, maybe it's true. Maybe you should stay and be with your kids, because obviously we were so little, and like it was tough for him not to be able to get there,
right?
But he did really great job of raising me and my sister.
Right? Yeah, you're a world away. You're in Latvia, and she's your mother goes missing in the United States. And let's just be honest, even though we have all these communication ways and everything else, but if this disappearance were to happen here in 2024, it might go kind of the same way. You know, you just can't like pick up from Latvia or some other country and just come to the United States right away.
Of course.
You know, there has to be a little planning, and everything that's involved here. Okay, so you did attempt to come here to try to figure out, but it seems like
but he would just never get visa because of like my mom got missing and she was illegal at that point then, even though she was missing, but they still were saying, oh, she's illegal in USA, so they just did not let him go
because she had a 6-month work visa.
They will let him
and at that point, if she got here in July or August of 98, we're getting to January, February, that's about 6 months.
Yeah, so she did become illegal
Right.
Because she missed the appointment.
Yeah.
She wouldn't miss the appointment, it would be okay until the application is going on. She could stay in America.
That's right.
Legally.
Right. So eventually a police report was filed. And of course, you're not here. Of course, you're just 7 or 8 years old at the time. But you've been working on this and for a while now. And that's why you're on Unfound. And we're doing this interview, by the way, on November 9th of 2024. Have you found out, did the police really do anything back in 1999 at all?
I found out that, unfortunately, they haven't done much, or they haven't done anything, because they did go around. They spoke to auntie, they spoke to the neighbors, and because everyone said the same thing, that they seen her going into the car, the police man actually told me that it's reported saying as she is an adult and she went by her will in the car, so it was her decision. And even now when I'm searching for her and I'm talking to police and I'm saying no, but she would never do that, like she would not go and not get in contact with us, like she would never leave us forever, they said like, yeah, they didn't do anything because that was not sign of a criminal for them.
Right. And it should be noted, maybe you know this now, Ilana, but, you know, local police, of course, you know, NYPD or local police or sheriff's office, you know, they really don't really, really do like immigration stuff. They're certainly more, you know, being that your mother eventually became somebody in the United States who, you know, was here illegally, they really don't do that stuff. They'll certainly help out. You know, even, of course, everybody knows about the immigration, you know, being this the political season, everybody knows about immigration from other countries. We talk about that a lot here in the United States. But it's really a federal government thing. It's not NYPD or New York State Police thing. So even if she is somebody whose visa has run out, how much work NYPD is going to do on that is not a lot. It's not something that they really, you know, are they're not their expertise, really not, you know, they're worried about robberies and car wrecks and murders and things like that. They're not worried about a woman who's here from Latvia whose visa has run out. So,
yeah, especially she didn't really have a family there to go and keep chasing them.
That's right. That's right. All right. So the police there back in 1999 didn't do a lot.
Yeah, nothing.
Okay. What you've learned, maybe, like I said, I'm not sure that you knew this, would understood this at the time, but I think maybe eventually have, so I have to ask this. What was your, being your auntie lived here in the United States, maybe she's still alive, still does live here, what was her reaction to Tatiana going missing? Did she ever offer up a theory or something as to what could have happened to her, being that she was the last person who your mother saw who you probably would trust? Any ideas?
Well, she couldn't say much, or she couldn't like do much. And of course she was worried, and she was pretty old at that point, because now she's 98 or 96.
Yeah.
So she couldn't do much, and of course it was a stress for her, because she obviously did feel a bit of responsibility for her.
Sure.
She did send us letters as well. They did had a phone calls with my dad. Like as I said, her relative did go to police, and actually that woman as well sent a letter once to my dad, telling all about how she went to police and she paid for a report and everything was done, and how she hopes that my mom will be found.
Mm-hmm.
Then we never got in contact with that woman again. But with auntie, yeah, even they met with my dad in Belarus once, because she had the family there after my mom got missing. But there is not much she can say, because my mom, yeah, she left her house and she was doing her things.
Yeah.
And she only could say again that she got changed. There was also something about, I don't know whether she got in a sect of, like, you know, some sort of belief.
Or, like a, what we call a cult or something?
Yeah, something like that maybe.
Okay, all right.
Because there was something that she's seen once, my mom, with like other few guys, and when she asked who are they, she mentioned something like brothers or something. Mm-hmm. So that was a bit weird.
Okay. But just to be clear though, your auntie never told, for example, your father, you know, here's what, you know, here's something, here's what might have happened, that, you know, she knew this, this is just an example, she knew this guy named John Smith, or, you know, she never, your auntie, even though she lived in the, had lived in the United States, lived there in New York City, she couldn't offer up a solid theory as to what could have happened to your mother.
No, I think it just within all the family members and her auntie as well, they all kind of had a sense that she got lied to and she just trusted someone. And yeah, okay. Everyone had that feeling that she just gone missing because somebody kidnapped her.
Okay. Now, everybody's probably wondering, well, what about she was living, you know, in a place? What about her possessions and everything? We're going to eventually get to that. It's on the outline, people. We're going to eventually get to that. But now we're going to go, so the police don't do much. She's missing. It's 1999. You know, there's not many leads or anything like that. She said she was going on this trip on January 25th, allegedly. And, you know, seemingly never came back, or, it, you know, she went missing. She's here in the United States. Yeah. She went missing somewhere. So let's jump into some of these things you've already mentioned and then also introduce some new facts into the discussion now. We'll just call this the rest of the case. I want to go back to that January 25th call that your mother, in it was your grandmother's opinion, said that Tatiana seemed rushed. She was like in a hurry.
Yeah. Okay. She was very like, you know, like not excited, but her voice was like very like and rushed and excited and like,
Not scared impressive. Or anything, just kind of excited, like.
Yeah, like very expressive, or I don't know, emotional and.
Okay, maybe something like would you explain it as maybe somebody who's fearing they might miss their flight or something like that, or some different type of
That something is going on, something that needs to be done, like probably excitement about things.
Okay, so she's rushed, and would that in the way you look at it, is that something that she had not done before? She had not acted like that before on a phone call, as far as you know?
Yeah, like she would be a bit different, a bit more like, she's still like very positive and fast and loud, but it would be a bit in a different way.
Okay. Let's move on to this. Of course, we talked about this haircut, and we do not have any photos of her with this haircut, do we?
No, because it was done just right before she got missing.
All right. Okay. So any pictures that we use for the marketing and advertising for this episode, all the pictures you see is not the hairstyle she had when she went missing. Do you happen to know where this haircut was even done? In Brooklyn, in Manhattan? Do you even know?
No, because she didn't really mention she only mentioned to one of her friends, that's it. Okay. And so she didn't mention where it was done.
Okay. The way you know your mother, the way your father knew your mother, of course she had longer hair. Ever have short hair? How much convincing do you think she would need to cut her hair?
I don't know, like no one ever seen her with a short hair. So everyone was surprised that she would have a short hair, and everyone would be like, oh, what would she look like with a short hair, I wonder. I remember, you know, playing with her hair, brushing it, and it was so long and thick. And I think it was kind of her style, you know, having a long hair. But I guess if she was excited and motivated of like getting a new job, getting her life sorted and that she can finally live in her dream place with her family. And I think she also wanted to be that bit of a hero when her family comes and everything is sorted.
Of course. Sure.
So that would not be a problem, I guess, for her. Yeah.
Okay.
For Katja.
You know, this is it's a little bit of a distressing thing to me is that, of course, you know, if you're in one kind of life, sometimes people do have to make changes in their dress, in their hair and other things if they're going to get a different kind of job or something like that. So it's something we do have to think about, but I don't know how often that happens that a woman has to get her hair cut to get a job. But, you know, if that's what she said, that's what she said.
No, she didn't say that she had to do her haircut to get a job.
Okay.
She was just mentioning that someone was there paying for her haircut, and she kind of was excited. Oh, I got a new haircut.
Okay. All right. Maybe she had long hair and she just woke up one day and said, you know what? I'm done with it.
Well, if somebody paid for it and was watching her doing haircut, I guess she was kind of, you know, motivated to do it.
Well, as a person, I don't know if you've seen pictures of me, but I have very long hair at 54 years old. And I'm here to tell you, it would take quite a bit of money for me to get my hair cut. There's a number at which I would get my hair cut, but it would probably be pretty high. So, okay. Of course, I could easily, I guess, grow it right back. So this is kind of also being that I also have long hair and take pride in it, that somebody would offer to, well, you need to get a cut or something and I'm going to pay for it or whatever. It's going to be a high number. So, you know, so this is also something that's going, just something that's going through my mind as we talk here. All right, let's move on to this. Now, this is something that, you know, you and I have discussed. And I don't know if we're opening a Pandora's box on this or not, but we have to talk about it. And it has to do, she said she had a job kind of being a nanny or babysitting, taking care of, a Jewish family making baby, taking care of their kids. But I have to ask you, in any of the communications you ever had with your mother, your father had ever had with your mother, did she ever mention their names?
No, no names, not that we know, not even the address. We just know they was in Brooklyn, and I only recently found out, like, I kind of have a rough idea where the house could be located, like roughly in a small area, because my auntie in Latvia, she found a card which my mom sent her birthday in November 1998. Like rushing, writing and saying in the card, like, happy birthday, I'm just right now here on this cross, and like writing the address where she is. And saying that, like, I'm sitting here writing you a card just before I start my job. And she mentioned the name of the street which the cross was at.
But your understanding, once again, going back to the first trip to Florida where we have those pictures, she went on that trip seemingly with this family. Of course, unfortunately, the pictures she sent you, there are no other family members in the picture, and that she never did say, I went with, this family to Florida.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, she sent a lot of pictures. From Miami, but there were no pictures with kids. There were no pictures with the whole family. There is a picture where she's standing and there is that building behind her, which I know what is it now. Before I didn't know the name of it, but then I could locate it. But there's also a woman sitting next to my mom, but kind of her face is looking down and she's kind of trying to put a t-shirt on. Like, to me, of course, I'm trying to be suspicious, but it looks like she's trying to hide her face. Like, she doesn't want to be on the photo.
Could be.
But she's so close that it's definitely not just someone random. I'm sure they were together.
And there's another picture of her standing and there's a guy sitting in a chair. on that trip?
Oh, yeah. And that was, my mom mentioned somewhere on the back of the photo that that was a doorman. But I don't know. I was trying to locate that that man and I couldn't so far. She was saying it's a doorman, but...
I don't even know how you go about doing that 20 feet with just a picture. That would be pretty, pretty difficult. You know, pretty difficult.
Yeah. So I do kind of believe that this could be a doorman. And the photo was taken because, I don't know, my mom was never in countries like America or any other part of that world.
Yeah.
She only was in Kazakhstan and Latvia, where like everyone is European, and maybe she was just like, just taking a picture of someone from America.
I guess what we're saying here is it very well may be that she was doing this job for this Jewish family, but it's curious to me, and this is it, as I've learned after 8 years, it pays to be cynical about these things, is that it's just a little surprising to me. She goes on a trip with them to Florida. You know, you go on a trip like this, usually pictures are taken. You would think that she would have sent one picture to you with her and, like, the kids or something. Just to say, but she never did anything like that.
Yeah, I'm sure she was working in Brooklyn for the Jewish family with kids, but I don't think now that she went with them to Miami. And that's obvious, like, she couldn't tell anyone of our family members that she's going with friends or whatsoever because of, maybe she would feel that she would get judged also, like, my dad and her mom were always trying to warn her of, like, don't trust anyone, don't go anywhere, like, wait for us to come over. And my mom was, like, super friendly, and she would trust anyone, and then she would be like, I know what I'm doing. And everyone is lovely and friendly, and no one can do harm to her. So I think, after, because she, like, my dad told me once how she would call him and be like, oh, I've got that friend, and she has a bit of a trouble, like, I don't know exactly what was it about, and he doesn't know as well, but she would mention, like, oh, I wish I can help her, I should help her, she's this and that, and my dad would be like, Tanya, please don't, like, don't do anything, don't get involved, because you, like, just wait for us to come over, don't go out, just stay safe there. And she would get annoyed and she would be like, oh, come on, you don't understand, it's fine. And then I guess after that she would just stop saying anything because everyone would always try to warn her and be like, and she would get annoyed at that and she just stopped telling anyone. So she only told her best friend about that interview at the end, because of course my dad would say, like, no, don't go there.
Okay. All right. So it's kind of, she wasn't telling anybody some things because, let's just say people didn't, treat her like an adult. You know, they're always looking for, she thought she could think for herself. I know what I'm doing. And, when she brings stuff up, people would try to make her feel stupid.
Kind of.
Okay. Let's move on to this. A lot to talk about regarding this guy, and this is where Tatiana's possessions and some other things are going to come up. Who is this guy, Walter? Now, my understanding is maybe that's like his real name is something. It's like Walter might be an Americanized name or not. You can explain it, but we're going to call him Walter. When did he first pop up on your radar regarding your mother's disappearance? So we'll just start with that.
Sure. So in 2006, my dad received a letter from Walter. On the envelope, it just says Walter and his address. In the letter, letter was written, handwritten in Russian language, but he would still write his name as a Walter in American, in English. Even though everything else is written in Russian. So I was like, are you trying to hide your name or what? And considering that he, as far as I'm right, and as far as I know, he's actually Ukrainian. And I know his full name. And Walter is probably like American version of that name.
Right.
So he doesn't have to use like Ukrainian name.
Right. So just, and we're not getting into his last name. We're not doing that here. We're just going to use his first name. His name is Walter, but in 2006, out of the blue, your father gets a letter from him.
Yeah, so he sent a letter to my dad saying hello and saying that, like, if you do receive this letter, try to respond back, at least a few words, or give me a call to States. Here is my number. And the last lines would be like, I just would like to know about the fate of your wife, Tatiana.
Huh.
I knew her. Yeah, he's like, dot, and then I knew her, dot. And then the last sentence is, and I have loads of different documents and her stuff.
Right. Your father must have been, were you there when your father read that? Were you there when that letter was received? Do you remember that moment? Your father must have been stunned.
Yeah, I do remember. And then obviously he called my grandmother and they decided that she's going to call him because, I don't know, she wanted to call him and talk to him. So she did. And as far as I know, they had a long conversation, and the main points that he said that, yes, he knew her, and he said that he came to visit her in Brooklyn, but then the owner of the house or the neighbors, whoever was there, told him, well, I believe the owner, because they said that she was not coming back for this and that time. Here are her belongings. If you want, just take them. If not, I'm going to throw them away. This is what he said. So he decided to take them. And so my grandma obviously asked him to send it to her. And he said, yes, yes, I will. Then he didn't. He didn't send it to her.
Mm-hmm.
So no one contacted him again until I did. It was in 2011.
Wow.
When I actually called him. And he was so well excited that I got in contact with him. And to me, he said that, yes, he has all this stuff. He said pretty much the same things that he told to my grandmother. Mm-hmm. But he said, no, I'm not going to send her things to you because they're mine. I was like, what do you mean they're yours?
Uh-huh.
Could you please send them to me?
Yeah.
He's like, no, I don't think I should because I got them. So if I got them, then I should just keep them. And he said he has photos of us because my mom, like, obviously my dad would send our pictures to her. Like, there was, you know, this September photos of me starting school and all that. So she had all those photos and he keeps them now. So, yeah, he refused to send this. Then when I was talking to him and trying to find out, like, if he knows, like, where is she, what she's doing and all that, he was like, yeah, I do have ideas where she can be, and I can try and help you to find her. Like, I know where to look for her, but then you have to come over, and then us together, we can find her. But you need to be sure you want to do this because it's very serious. And I was like, no, but just tell me now, like, what is it? Where is it? Just give me clues. He's like, no, I can't. You have to come here first, and then we try and find her. Like, I have ideas. I know, yes. And that was a bit of like, no, but just tell me, like, where? What is it? And he would just refuse and just keep going on about, like, only if you come here, then...
Okay, let me, we need to really get into some of these things. All right, so thank you for going over that, and we'll come back to continuing that further. So he somehow got your father's address in Latvia, where you were living, and sent him a letter.
Yeah.
All right, so any idea how he got your address in the first place?
Well, since he got all her things from room where she stayed, there must be all of the letters that my dad sent her.
Okay,
so there would be the address.
All right, so that's
he had her notebook as well.
Right, that's a good explanation. Now, the next question is, Did he ever explain how he knew Tatiana? Did he know her as a neighbor? Did he know her because he ran into her at a restaurant? Did they go to the same church together? Did he, has he ever explained how he knew her?
Yeah, so when I asked him, he said that his female friend introduced her to him. I believe there was a big Russian-speaking community, like people who spoke Russian, like from all Soviet Union countries. They all came to New York and, you know, they kind of kept together, staying together. Somebody introduced her to him. And so he said that he helped her to find that Jewish family to work in the house, to clean the house. And I believe he also found her this place to live in Brooklyn, that room.
Mm-hmm.
You see, my mom went to learn English at some point.
Yeah.
American.
Okay.
And possibly there she got to know people and made friends. Mm-hmm. And this is how it's all started. But yeah, I believe, well, he did say he fell in love with her.
He
and
did.
All that.
Wow.
Yes. And so he was trying to help her with job, with all that.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So he says he was introduced to her through a friend, their mutual friend. Once again, this is just the way I have to be, Ilana. Did he ever say this woman's name?
He didn't, because actually I don't remember from 2011, but because I called him again in 2021, I asked him, do you have a contact of that woman? Do you know what's her name? He's like, no, I don't remember. That was a long time ago. I was like, yeah, but you remember my mom's name, but you don't remember the name of that friend?
Right. Right. Good point. Good point.
Yes. Well, my best point actually is about the letter.
Yeah.
If he just knew my mom and he just went to visit her and he realized she's not there, okay, fine. Then he never got in contact with her since. And then he sends a letter, 7 years after, to my dad.
Right.
To find out how is my mom's life.
Yep.
Why did he not send a letter assuming my mom just went back home?
I agree with you. That's a very good point. He addressed the letter to your father, not to her.
Yeah, so he was so sure that she never made it back home.
Very interesting. Good one. All right, very curious. Being that your auntie lives in the United States, did she know anything about Walter? Did anybody ever ask her? Do you know anything about this Walter guy?
Not as far as I know.
Okay.
No.
Now, what's interesting is he wasn't, you should know this, Ilana, but we hear a lot of crazy stories here on this podcast. And we hear a lot of things about people having missing person stuff that doesn't end up being true. We hear a lot of things that don't end up being true on this podcast. Very common. The thing is, Walter was telling the truth. He did have your mother's stuff, didn't he?
Yeah.
And including, for example, he actually was in possession of her passport.
Yes, he said that to me in 2021, I think.
Finally.
Yeah. He said, because when I was... Okay, I don't know whether I should start it now.
Let me just ask you this. So his story is that at some point he went looking for your mother. He shows up at where she used to live in Brooklyn. And seemingly whoever was there just gave him all her stuff. Some stranger.
Yeah. That's
his story.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think I never got a clear answer of why did the owner of the house not give the stuff to police?
Right.
And I never got the clear answer from him, why did he not take her stuff to police? He could not answer this question.
Okay. I also think we have to start wondering, he didn't email your message or write a letter to your father to 2006, that's 7 years later. Did he have all of that stuff all of that time, or did he just come into the possession of it in 2005, 2006? Do you know?
No, yeah, he had it all the time because he said, yeah, he said when he came to visit her and she was not there, the owner just said, like, yeah, you can just have all her stuff. So she had it since then.
Okay, and it took him 7 years to write your father on this.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And never send her things. Like, why would he not send the things with the letter to my dad? And be like, here you go. That's her stuff.
I don't know. He sounds like a quirky guy, and I have looked him up. I do know his full name. He is an American citizen, and he has a couple things on his criminal record, but nothing that... nothing violent or anything like that. So this is all very unusual, but you talked to him in 2011 and then later. And in fact, let's get back to something. He tried to get you to come to the United States.
Yeah. That conversation, to be honest, was really weird in 2011.
Yeah.
Considering I was very young and he would... Like, I ask him one question, he says completely something off topic, which I'm not interested about, like about his daughter, about his other life, about business, whatsoever, but nothing that I actually ask him. So he would literally try to move conversation and completely, totally the other way, which I'm not interested about. Mm-hmm. And all the time saying, and after he was so pushy about like, oh, if you come, then, I can't tell you now. It's so serious. Like, I can't tell you. You have to come here. You have to be here for me to tell you and for us to find her. So obviously I just, I was a bit stuck with that information because.
So being that I haven't spoken to him, but you have, and in fact you spoke to him again, and you did get her stuff eventually, right?
Oh no, I never did.
Never did. Okay, never did.
No.
So when you're talking to him, of course you're an adult now. I'm an adult. We've all spoken to kind of crazy people in life, whether they're drunk or they're high or they have some mental health issue or whatever. When you think about talking to Walter and you're trying to get him to answer a question and he's talking about other things, does he sound crazy, evasive, or what? Your opinion.
I think he's just a lost old man. This one.
Okay. All right.
Talking to him, I was feeling a bit sorry. Like.
Okay.
Yeah, he's just lost in his life, I think.
Okay.
And I do not trust any single word that he says.
Okay, but we can't deny he has your mother's stuff.
He does.
And seemingly still has your mother's stuff.
Yeah.
25 years after she went missing.
Yes. Well, in 2021, when I said, so how about her things? Like, do you still have them? He was like... Yeah, I had them probably somewhere. Yeah, I don't know. I was moving so many times. I don't know. They might be somewhere. I was like, could you send them to me? He's like, yeah, but I need to find them. But my mom is ill now. But I don't know. Like, I don't know where they are. Like, in that case, you either know or you don't know about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, yeah, but can you please look for them then? He's like, oh, maybe, but I don't know. Like, when, how, I don't know. So he was so uncertain about it. And I was like, please, it's important for me to have them. And he was like, yeah, I'll see. I was like, okay, how about I give you a call like a week later or so and see where you are, if you could find them or not. He's like, yeah, maybe, yeah, let's try. And then I think I phoned him like a month later or so and his number was off. And I think he changed his number after our conversation. But then I found his number again. But then I still couldn't reach him. And to be honest, I'm still waiting for my next moves with him.
All right. So unfortunately, Walter couldn't just be some regular guy who calls and says, yeah, I got your mother's stuff and I want to ship it to your father in Latvia or whatever. Couldn't be that simple, could it?
No, yeah. He had to play some games
with all of us.
With my grandmother saying that, yes, he is going to send it to her. With me in 2011 saying, no, I'm not sending it to you because they're mine. And in 2011, after the police got in contact with him, he refused. He said, what? Why would I say I would wouldn't send it to you. Of course I would, but I didn't know where to. And I was like, well, you said you're not going to send them to me. He's like, no, why would I say that? No, I wouldn't say that. And I was like, okay, do you still have them? He's like, maybe I do. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe somewhere I need to look for them. Well, and I said, okay. I'm repeating myself now.
Is he aware of the, you know, guy, I guess going back to 2006 or 2011, your pick, was he aware that your mother's missing?
Yeah. So obviously after my grandma called him, like they were discussing, and obviously she confirmed that, yes, we haven't heard of her, from her, anything.
Okay. Now the police did talk to him. You somebody's convinced them, you know, NYPD, you need to go talk to this guy. In what year did that happen?
Well, you see, no, actually I asked police not to get in contact with him.
Oh, you did.
Right. I did ask them not to. Like, I gave them his contacts, but I was like, please, can you not get in contact with him just yet? Because otherwise he's not going to ever repeat all this to me again, of like what he did in 2011. Mm-hmm. And when I called him in 2021, assuming the police never got in contact with him, he goes to me, oh, so you're searching for your mom? Because police was visiting me or calling me, something like that. I was like, oh gosh, like, well, yeah, right. Of course I'm looking for her, yes. So yeah, and I like from that point, I knew he's not gonna say anything,
right,
as what he did in 2011. And I was like, oh, please, I so regret that I never came around. But do you remember you said, like, if I come around, you can help me to find her? He was like, no, like, I don't know where to look for her. Why would I say that? No, I didn't say that. I was like, no, but you were saying that you can help me. You know where to look for her. I'm ready now. He's like, no, I don't know. I wouldn't. Like, how would I know where she's gone? So, yeah, he refused.
Like I said, no, you couldn't be as fortunate as to find a good American, good, stable, you know, healthy, mentally American who gets her stuff. No, you had to get some guy like this, unfortunately.
Yeah.
You couldn't get that lucky. Yeah. You know, and of course, people are thinking, well, could water have something to do with Tatiana's disappearance? I guess it's possible. You know, that's something that all of you, the listeners, will have to decide for yourselves. But it sure is weird. When was the last time you actually spoke to him?
In 2021. Okay. That was the last time.
And the listeners should know, as far as I can tell, he is still alive. All right, so there's this guy who seemingly still has Tatiana stuff. She's a missing woman for 25 years, and some guy that I guess knew her has her stuff, even though they didn't live together and just kind of showed up there one day and somebody gave her stuff, including her passport, which I guess it means that we have to be open to the idea that if Tatiana, you know, goes missing, that she didn't leave the United States. Okay.
She was also not allowed to leave the United States, right, but she was applying for all this.
Right, right. So let's move on. So let's move on to this now. And that is the Brighton Beach Club. Once again, to remind everybody, is this something that your mother mentioned, or is this something that somebody else mentioned about her possibly working there?
Yeah, so this was her second job that she was just, I guess, earning extra money. This again, conversation with her best friend from Kazakhstan. She was the only one who knew about it.
Okay.
We don't know exactly the place. My mom just said that there was a restaurant, a bar on Brighton Beach. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so she was just working there. But we didn't know much about it. When I started to look around at like what restaurants and bars were there and are there now, there is the Tatiana restaurant, which caught my attention. Because obviously, you know, if I would be my mom, being in New York and seeing a restaurant that's called Tatiana, I would be happily working there.
Okay.
That's called my name.
Yeah, right.
It's my name and all Russian community again, like Russian-speaking people. But the owner of that restaurant is called Tatiana, and I think she's from Odessa, Ukraine.
I have to ask, this place, is it still around? Does that place still exist today, 25 years later?
Yes, it
does.
Yes, it is. Okay. And actually, a second restaurant of Tatiana is in Miami, Florida, and the owner also lives in Miami, Florida.
Wow, what a coincidence.
Yeah.
All right, that's something else to think about. Now, I need to ask you something. I don't know about today, but back in 1999, did that place have a reputation? You know what that means? You know, kind of,
and yes and no.
You know, a little shady reputation. What have you learned about this place?
I think there was like a problems for the owners, because I think in the beginning they were like husband and wife, then they got divorced and that was their own business. Mm-hmm. There was like, I think it's a very famous place for, again, Russian speaking community people, like being there, and the staff would constantly change. And also, there was that other missing woman from New York, which was very young.
Yeah, let's talk.
She gone missing. I think she was working in that Tatiana restaurant as well, as far as I'm aware.
Okay, and we can mention her name. Her name is Irina, I-R-I-N-A, Irina Monastima. That's the best I can do.
Monastirna, yeah.
Yeah, I just killed it with my American English. M-O-N-A-S-T-Y-R-N-A, Monastirna. Monastirna is, I just got this information from Ilana today. I've not had a chance to look it up. Probably in my summation after this interview for the episode, I'll maybe, if I can find anything, I'll give you some more details, all the listeners out there, about what went on. But she went missing. She worked at this Brighton Beach Club.
I believe so, yeah. If I'm right, there was that connection.
Okay.
And they both go missing from Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like a lot of people who know
What year did Irina go missing?
Sorry?
What year did Irina go missing?
2005.
All right, so 6 years later. Okay.
Yeah. But she was also, she kind of looks a bit similar to my mom as well.
Okay.
And, you know, they're both young immigrants from post-Soviet Union countries with no family in USA, both having, you know, language barriers and fever connections.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Where she was Irina from Latvia or somewhere else?
She was Ukraine.
Ukrainian. Okay, so we got Tatiana from Latvia going missing in 99, and then we have Irina, once again, I-R-I-N-A, from Ukraine, who goes missing in 2005. Any allegations that the two could have known each other?
I don't think so, because she came to New York after my mom did, okay. I believe.
All right, just checking. And once again, for the listeners, I'll do what I can to find out anything I can about Irina's disappearance and seeing if it's similar to Tatiana's. So there's something there. Maybe it's a coincidence, maybe it's not. Let's move on to this. Now, you did just speak about language barrier. This came up in a disappearance earlier this year, where a young woman from Italy went missing in New Orleans. And talking about the English language, any other languages, you said that your mother was learning to speak English.
Uh-huh.
And how good, in your opinion, in 1999, how good was her English?
It's hard to tell for sure, but I can say that my mom was very good at languages, like with picking up languages.
Mm-hmm.
And she started learning it like before she went to New York, like when she started planning to go to New York. I literally remember her sitting like and learning English with vocabulary,
mm-hmm.
but she could speak quite a lot of languages, like six, if we include English.
Wow.
so if yeah, I believe like she could understand everything and she would try speak English when she was in America. Definitely.
Okay. Of course, if she, you know, if she's out, of course, we of course hope that, of course, that she's still alive here 25 years later. I don't know what the odds are of that. We, of course, don't know what happened. But she would speak English, but she would speak it with some sort of accent.
Probably a Russian accent, because it's still quite strong.
Okay. Because I bring this up, Ilana, because in this other disappearance, her name was Elena Carissi from Italy. Even though she was from Italy, she had, before she went missing, she had spent a lot of time in the United States. And the friend of hers, who was the guest for that episode, stated that she could speak English like an American. That, you know, she was, her English was so good or so Americanized and everything that she could probably blend in generally. Of course, we have different accents and everything here in the United States. But in general, she could blend in anywhere in the United States. With your mother, though, she would speak English, but you'd hear the accent, like what we would call the Russian accent. I realize she wasn't Russian, but yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, because also her first language was Russian, like. Mm-hmm. So usually Russian people have really strong accent.
Yeah.
Like not Russian people, Russian-speaking people, they would have really strong Russian accent. And it's really difficult to get rid of that. When actually, like, let's say if your first language is Latvian language, speaking English, you almost have no accent. Like, you can speak with mistakes, but then you will almost have no accent, yeah.
That's interesting.
At least not as strong, yeah.
Okay. What other, I guess somewhat important, what other languages could your mother speak?
So she could speak Kazakh language because she grew up in Kazakhstan.
Okay.
Ossetian because she was born in Ossetia.
Okay.
And at school she was learning German and she was quite good at German language. Wow. Not fluent, but yes, it was kind of good.
Okay.
And then when she came to Latvia and she met my dad and everyone I know from my family now saying that she picked up Latvian language so fast that everyone was really impressed by that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Okay.
And obviously Russian language.
Okay, very good. So, you know, I think that's all the facts that we have here in 2024 regarding your mother's disappearance. And I hate it. Elena, that, you know, that your mother went missing in my country. Of course, we have a lot of missing people here. And Americans going missing is bad enough. But when we have people coming from other countries who are looking for new way of life, looking to improve themselves, want to bring their families over here, and then they go missing, it just seems worse. You know, so how hard have the last 25 years been? Of course, for you. Of course, we can't forget you have a younger sister, your father. Can you go into that?
Well, I can say in general, as growing up as a child, me and my sister, because of my dad, I think we had amazing childhood. Like, it could have been a lot worse, considering that my mom went missing. And we've just been really blessed having my dad. And if my mom ever, like, if I ever will see my mom, I want her to know of, like, how amazing our dad is. Because he made everything possible and impossible for us to have a happy childhood. He spent like all his time, all his money, just all for us. Mm-hmm. And of course, he's been waiting for her all this time. Mm-hmm. And he never lost his hope. And he's probably the one who like put this belief in us that she will eventually come back and we will see her one day. He was my great support, I think, in all that. Even until now, still, he supports me a lot in this search. Of course, you know, like, he doesn't speak English. He never did. None of my family members actually speak English. Huh. So, and it's really tricky without English to do anything, like, to find her.
Yeah.
But I remember him always collecting like every piece of a newspaper where he finds information, something about America, like something about, there was that detective that he found out about who lives in New York. And then he was coming around to Latvia, to Riga, and he left his details on the side. And then now when I was starting my search again, like a proper search, nice. I asked him about it and he's like, yeah, I have it. And he sent it to me, like, that detective's contacts, and I got in contact with that detective.
Wow. Who is he? Some detective from New York went to Latvia?
Yeah, he kind of had that post-Soviet Union relations to, yeah.
Okay.
Like, he does speak Russian a little bit.
Okay.
And he had some things to do in Riga, yeah, and Latvian newspapers would write about him. That he was that great.
Who is this guy? So who is this guy? I'd be interested to know. Maybe if you don't know it right now, that's fine. I'm not going to ask you to look it up, but I'd be interesting to know who that is.
I will give you the name a bit later.
Okay, that's fine. That's totally fine. Let's move on to this. Of course, you were just 7, 8 years old when this happened. You know, at what point in your life did you decide to make this a concern? You know that, of course, you're being interviewed here tonight, and you know, when did you start working on it? Is immediately like when you like turned 15 or 18 or what?
Well, I was living with that all my life.
Yeah,
since my mom
right.
went missing.
Right.
I always thought that like first, of course, like 8 years old, 9 years old, I was like, we're waiting for her. She's gonna come back. And I was trying to be a good child and not to stress out my dad, because I could see him being worried enough about my mom gone missing. So I was trying not to ask too many questions because I could feel it's hard. And I was also like trying to kind of cope with my own emotions within myself and not showing it to anyone. But I always, like every day, literally, I was thinking like, she will come back. And I was waiting for her for so long. And I was like thinking of her literally every day. And then I had my best friend at school, like primary school. And I was talking to her about my mom, like quite often, of like how much I want her to come back, like that I will have to look for her one day. You know, I like, me as a child, I had those dreams about me being rich one day and spending all my money for my mom's search.
Yeah.
Making up all dreams I could. Like every my like all birthday, you know, cakes when you blow a cake and you make a wish, you know what my wish was. My wish was always to find my mom, to see her again.
Yeah.
And yeah, so basically started from school probably when I was like, I have to do something. So talking to my friend, she's quite religious and, you know, like church community is also quite wide around the world. So some pastors from Latvia, they would have connections in America and they would have those websites within the community. And so we did make a post about my mom within that church community. That was my first kind of small step
yeah.
for people to find out about this, my mom's story. Then there was, back then when I was still at school, in Moscow, they had that TV show about missing people that they would look from around the world, like for missing people, and eventually some of them would be found. So I did send them letter as well. They didn't respond anything. Then there was internet days starting and computer dates. Like I got my first computer, and then I put it up on the website, actually, my mom's story. But again, no one ever had anything to do with that case. And then I think I moved out of Latvia to a different country in, I don't know, 2010 maybe.
Okay.
And 2011 was when I was brave enough to call Walter.
Yeah.
And then I was like, what else can I do? What else can I do? I didn't have a chance to go to America, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But I am planning it as soon as I will be able to.
Yeah.
And then I think in 2018 or 19, when I first did that Facebook page for my mom, which is existing until today, that was also, I was talking to one of my friends. You know, like before, I was never telling anyone about my mom's story because I felt like, I don't want to hear this. Oh, poor child. Yeah. I didn't want to feel that. I didn't want to hear that. Like, yeah. I'm not so poor as you think. My dad is amazing. Yes, I had my pain for my mom. It's a big loss. Like,
yeah, of course.
Of course, my childhood would be much better with my mom. But considering I did not have my mom, my dad was amazing. He is still now like my best friend, and he was like for mom and for dad to us. But anyway, yeah, this is what people's reaction was, and that would just make me a bit like upset, and I would have tears, and I did not want to talk about it. So I would never talk about my mom's story. But then when I was older, and I was like, okay, people need to know about my mom's story.
Yeah,
maybe someone can help. Maybe someone can advise something.
Right.
And then the more I started talking about my mom, the more ideas came up to my head. And like, I was like, once, because all the time I would be Googling my mom's name in Russian letters. Like I would type in Russian.
Yeah.
And then I was like, hold on, but she went to America. I need to type in English. And if I would type in English, there was nothing. And I was like, okay. Facebook page. There we go.
Yes.
And this is how it's all started. And at some point, I was so on it, like having a full-time job, having a child, having other responsibility. I would still spend time on like looking for my mom. And I ended up like sleeping about 4 hours a day.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. And then still trying to balance my life a bit with all this.
Right. Wow. Okay. And as you stated kind of in there, just passing, you've never been to the United States.
No, not yet. But I wanted to do it badly. I will eventually, and hopefully as soon as possible. But unfortunately, the life is not that easy even for me. So.
Right. All right. Well, the United States will be here when you're ready, Ilana.
Thank you.
We'll be ready for you. We'll throw out the red carpet.
It's going to happen very soon.
Okay, good.
I'm on it.
Okay. All right. What about your younger sister? Not as involved as you are in all of this or not?
No, she's not. Of course, she's lovely. She's amazing. We're very close. Mm-hmm. And she has nothing against that. She supports me completely. But in a way, it's probably more difficult for her because she doesn't know my mom,
right.
Our mom.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
she was not even three yet at that point. She was turning three later after my mom left. But that year, the same year, but still. So yeah, my sister, she's okay.
Okay.
You see, it was me who had this, my mom's words of like, look after your sister and your dad until we all like reunion. Mm-hmm. So it's, I feel like it's my thing that I have to do, and otherwise no one else will do. And again, like my sister doesn't speak English as well. So I feel I have more power here than she does. But I think my most greatest support is my dad.
Okay. Yeah, your English is really good, Ilana. Your English is really, 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 really good. I have no problems understanding you at all. So I congratulate you on that. Because as a writer, and I only speak and only write English, but I know that the English language is tough. You got a lot of weird things going on in this language. So somebody that can learn it and communicate, especially when we're talking about a disappearance, that's pretty good.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. You mentioned the Facebook page. Why don't you tell the listeners about it right now? What's the name of it?
Yeah, so my mom's page on Facebook is Missing Tatiana Lupaca. If you pronounce it in as how you spell it. So missing T-A-T-I-A-N-A, because my mom's name also gets spelled in many different ways.
Yes.
But the correct one, which I'm using for Facebook, is T-A-T-I-A-N-A,
yes.
Tatiana.
Yeah.
And her last name, L-U-P-A-C-A, which pronounces as Lupaca, but actually Lupac.
Okay.
But yeah, there you go. Missing Tatiana Lupaca.
Yeah. Yeah, Lupaca sounds Lupaca sounds Italian. Lupaca, at least in American English, sounds Italian. Of course, she was not Italian.
No, it's only because of that C letter at the end of the word is... when you take it out of Latvian passport, Latvian language, you have that thing on the top of the C letter, which makes it sound as Che, so it makes it Lupacha.
Yes.
Which is, again, Latvian version of the last name. In Russian version, you would have just Lupac.
Okay.
Gotcha. That's why sometimes you can see me spelling her last name as L-U-P-A-C-H.
Okay.
Which is kind of also correct. But yeah, just so many ways. Even actually, I've noticed my mom would spell her names and last names different in some, like her last and first name, in a letter she would put one way, in a document different way. So yeah, it's
okay.
It's weird.
All right. So it's spelled L-U-P-A-C-A, but pronunciation-wise, if we want to be correct here on Unfound, it's Lupic.
Lupic, yeah.
All right, very good.
Tatiana Lupic, if you say it in Russian. Tatiana Lupaca, if you say it in Latvian.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. Ilana, any final words before we complete this interview?
Well, I actually probably wanted to add as well that...
Go ahead.
Like, I can get contacted as well through the email, which I made for my mom. Which is missing Tatiana at gmail.com.
All right, great.
So, yeah, you can get in contact with me if needs to through the Facebook or that email.
Okay, why don't you say that one more time? Say the email address one more time, Ilana.
So it's missing Tatiana, T-A-T-I-A-N-A.
Okay.
All one word.
Okay.
At gmail.com.
All right, very good. Anything else?
I believe that's probably it. I'm just very grateful that I came across you, or you came across me.
Yes. Whatever. It doesn't matter who contacted who first. We're here together now.
Thank you so much. I'm really grateful. Like, I'm really surprised of how many nice people are here in the world. And I'm truly, like, grateful to every single one of who's...
Yeah.
Helping me or contacting me, I get lots of nice messages, lots of good ideas. And in advance, I want to say sorry if I ever missed anyone's message, because I do get quite a lot of messages.
Well, you know, after this podcast comes out, you're going to have a lot more friends here in the United States. So that even gives you one more reason to come over here and see this beautiful country.
Yeah, I can't wait, to be honest, to meet a lot of people who I know now just because of my mom's case.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So thank you very much to everyone. And of course you.
Oh, well, you're very welcome, and I appreciate you being on this episode of Unfound.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And that was my November 9th, 2024 interview with Ilana, oldest daughter of Tatiana Lupic. I thank her for joining me and all of you on this episode. There was something in the interview that needed more explanation that I missed in the moment, so I'm going to cover it now. In the interview, Ilana mentioned that Tatiana and her husband and daughters were not just applying for citizenship in the United States. They were actually asking for asylum. A few days after the interview, I asked Ilana about this, because asylum could mean somebody or a group was after the Lupic family. Here is word for word what Ilana told me. According to those documents, and the documents she's talking about can now be found on Unfound's website, theunfoundpodcast.com. Yes, I think my parents were trying to get the rights to live in the USA via asking for asylum. I think the economical and political situation in Latvia wasn't good since it became independent in 1991 when the USSR fell apart. Ilana went on to say, I'm going through my mom's letters. I think the main reason for asking asylum was that my father, who was born in Latvia, and I, who was also born in Latvia, did not have Latvian citizenship despite being born there. That's why my mother was gathering documents such as birth certificates and asking my dad to find articles in Latvian newspapers mentioning that all non-citizens of Latvia might be expelled from the country by 2002. And that ends Ilana's statement on this topic. The way I would decipher what she says right there at the end about the Latvian newspaper articles is I'm guessing that the father was going to send those articles to the United States, to Tatiana, so she could present them to U.S. authorities as proof that she wasn't making it up, that yes, they actually need asylum in the United States because of what could happen to them back there in Latvia. My additional insight is that the asylum request had nothing specifically to do with the Lupic family. Instead, this was an action that many Latvians were probably taking at the time. The bottom line is, I do not believe Tatiana's disappearance has anything to do with the asylum request. The other topic that I have to follow up on from the interview is the disappearance of Irina Monastirna, who went missing from New York City in 2005. Could her disappearance and Tatiana's be connected? The answer? Maybe. What strikes me first about Tatiana and Irina is they could be sisters. Almost twin sisters. That is how much they look alike. In fact, in preparing this episode, I actually made a mistake where I put up a picture of Irina instead of Tatiana in the marketing of this episode. That is how much they look alike. Another similarity is that the work histories for both are vague at best. Yes, they were making money somehow, but the source of the income was unknown. Of course, remembering that Tatiana never revealed the name of that Jewish family. And that Jewish family has never come forward to identify themselves over the last 25 years. Another similarity, on the days of their disappearances, both women talked to family. And the topic of conversation was of importance. For Tatiana, it was the trip to Miami. For Irina, it was that she recently got married without telling anyone. And we can't forget, they lived and disappeared from Brooklyn. But are there differences? Yes. With Irina, she herself said she got married. In fact, she came to the United States married, but then got divorced. This is a much different situation than Tatiana's. Tatiana was from Latvia. Irina was from Ukraine. There's nothing I've seen saying that Irina was on the verge of becoming a citizen. In fact, the guy she married, allegedly, was not a U.S. citizen either. By the way, he has never been tracked down. With Tatiana, she got her paperwork for citizenship in the mail right after disappearing. What do I think? I think any person who entertains the idea that these disappearances are connected is being very rational. However, that doesn't make the person correct. What I think would make the connection stronger is if someone could prove the two had mutual friends, remembering that the disappearances occurred 6 years apart. As for Walter having Tatiana's stuff, it has to qualify to be in the top 20 of the most unexpected facts we've encountered on Unfound. That he volunteered that he had her stuff actually makes him less guilty in my eyes, but your mileage may vary. But for both Tatiana and Irina, and all the other foreigners who've disappeared here, We have to do better because people are not going to stop coming to America. If you'd like to hear and read more of my in-depth analysis into the disappearance of Tatiana Lupaca, please go to patreon.com/unfoundpodcast, sign up, and partake in the Unfound blog. Until then, I leave the public theorizing up to you. I'm Ed Densel, and you've been listening to Unfound.